بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الحمد لله عدد خلقه رضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته ومنتهى علمه من جمع ما شاء وخلق وزرع وبرع عالم غيب شهادة الرحمن الرحيم المالك القدوس العزيز الحكيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك له الحمد يحيي ويميت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وحبيبه وخليله وأرسله بهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله لو كره المشركين. ما بعد. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. أخ طالب. My brother Talib. Alright, so continuing, so a brief recap from last week. We went over the 13, in this case in Usul al-Din, 20 attributes, 21. We also discussed and learned those things that are wajib about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those things that are mustahil, those things that are impossible or absolutely unacceptable to believe about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you had those things that were jaiz, right? We talked about those three things. We also know that those things are also, that knowledge that you must know transfers also over to the prophets and the messengers, right? What is to be believed that is necessary for them? What is to be believed with regards to them, those things that are mustahil, those things that are impossible, and then also those things that are jaiz, permissible or possible with regards to them. So now we move to the third category within Usul al-Din, and this is where you find the motivating factor of the believers, you know, is those things that are connected to the Sami'at. Those things that are narrated that you hear about, but it's mandatory for you to understand, believe in them, understand them and believe in them as well. The Sami'at, or the afterlife, comes from the same word sama, right? To hear. Who do you hear them from? From Allah and His Messenger. Even if you look at how the order is set up, the order is first you learn about the ilahiyat with regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you learn about the Messenger, and then you learn about the Sami'at. Those things are Sami'at, they can only be told to you about Allah and by Allah and His Messenger, right? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the first thing that the Shaykh, he mentions, rahimahullah, he says that all of the malaika, all of the angels are ma'zum, immune to defect, and they're sinless, right? They're immune to defect and also being immune to sins. And in that, they do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what He commands them. And they do not, they do whatever they're commanded. And they are composed of light, right? And they're neither male nor female. They do not eat or drink. And if you've seen it in your lifetime, I'm not going to say everybody's seen it. If you've seen it in your lifetime, the images that they depict as being angels are usually little, pale-skinned, butt-naked babies, usually when you see them, with wings on them, right? Some of them have young boys with wings on them. They always made the male, and then, you know, maybe they got a touch, a splash of the equal opportunity. Then they'll have an image of a female angel. Somehow, maybe a wing is covering her breast or something like that. I don't know. But anyway, we know from Islam that is not applicable to them. They're not male nor female, you know. They don't get hungry or thirsty. They don't disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also another further proof that would refute the Christian ideology that Lucifer was a falling angel, right? You know, all of these things. We know that Iblis, Shaitan, La'an Allah alayhi, may Allah ta'ala continue to curse him. I mean, he was a jinn. He wasn't a angel. Okay? So this is basic creed of the Muslim. So they don't eat or drink. So, you know, and we know about the angels and we know the truth. See, this is the thing about Islam. When it comes from Allah and comes from the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, doubt is equivalent to kufr, right? Having doubt in what you learn is almost equal to disbelief or tantamount to disbelief, right? It's that close. Now, it is different. Of course, a doubt where the question sounds as if you're having doubt in a thing, that's different from a person who truly doubts. And the proof of that is from the Quran, what Allah Ta'ala, he says, إِنَّمَا مُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتَرْبُوا. Belief is that you believe in Allah, his messenger, and after that, don't have any doubt, right? So this, you know, having doubt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mawjud, this is kufr, right? There's no room for that, you know. Having doubt that there's a possibility that Allah may liken to his creation is kufr. Meaning that Allah may be contained within his creation, this is kufr, right? All of these things, anything that's leading to any type of doubt is disbelief. Right, it takes you outside of Islam, no matter how white your thobe is, how long your beard is, or how nice your kufi look. If you hold doubt in the existence of these things, or hold doubt in the things that are in the Quran, right? You know, Allah says in the Quran about the Quran, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, right? That in this book, meaning the Quran, لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, there's no doubt in it, right? So meaning whatever you read in the Quran is absolute haq. There's no room for doubt. Like, even like some of the people who like to play games with the Quran. Well, you know, that doesn't say, you know, I don't know, whatever they try to give interpretation to, whether it was challenging things of that nature. You know, you have to be careful. These things will carry you outside of Islam. And these things, especially these things that are pertaining to the Semiat, those things that are narrated and heard, who are they narrated from? From Allah, his messenger, right? So the next thing that the Sheikh, he mentions, he says the Kutub al-Samawiyya, right? The heavenly or revealed books, okay? Now, those revealed books, meaning the, which is mentioned by name in the Quran, the Torah, right? The Torah. And the messenger that was associated with the Torah was Musa alayhi salam, right? The Torah, you have the Injil, which is the gospel, and the messenger that is associated with the Torah is Isa ibn Maryam, right? You have the Zubur. The Zubur, which is also known as the Psalms of Dawood or Psalms of David, right? That's the messenger that's associated with the Zubur. You have the Suhuf, the leaflets or the pages, and they, you know, the pages that the messenger that is associated with the Suhuf is commonly known, Ibrahim alayhi salam, right? So we believe that all of them once existed in their purest form. They all existed in their purest form. But however, they all been abrogated by the Quran. So we're no longer obligated to follow it, right? This was a big fitna 20 something years ago, maybe even almost 30 years ago, that people had when they used to talk about the Bible. Like, oh no, we're supposed to believe in the Bible. No, firstly, the Bible is a compilation, you know, and it's it's rewired, its narration is usually through King James. Or I think it's the Holy something International or the International Bible. So, you know, those aren't the routes we narrate the Bible from, firstly. So, secondly, the Bible is a compilation, right? It's a compilation. You know how they'll have books, they'll take a voluminous book, like a four-volume book, and compile them all into one book. Well, the Bible in itself is a compilation of the Old Testament, right, the Psalms, right, and the New Gospel, right? And then, you know, basically they say the New Gospel, those things and the New Gospel is no longer applicable. I mean, our Old Testament is no longer applicable because they follow the New Testament and so on and so forth. And on top of that, it's written in English. Yeah. So, or French, or whatever the case is. And yeah, of course, you know, you can say, hey, well, that's just his interpretation. Well, the original form of the Injil was revealed in Aramea, right? The original form of the Torah was revealed in Hebrew, and I'm almost sure that the Psalms or the Zabur, the Psalms, was revealed in Hebrew as well, and none of them are, you know, in that form no more. So anyway, the bottom line is the Quran abrogated the Muslims to follow them, but however, we must affirm that these books actually exist, and when they existed, they were in their purest form that Allah revealed them, and Allah Ta'ala abrogated that by means of the Quran, and people also distorted it and changed its meaning and so on and so forth. All right. So the Kutub al-Samawiyya, he said they're all a haq and they're all siddiq. They're real and they're also truth, right? Meaning before and its past tense. And the final revelation, of course, was the Quran, and was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, maut, death at its appointed time, is connected to the Sami'at. As a matter of fact, once you die, you enter into the realm of what is known as the Barzakh, the barrier between the Qiyamah and the Dunya, right? That is, once you enter into that grave, you're in that realm of the Barzakh, right? So he mentions that death at its appointed time is real. So what are some of the events that take place in the Barzakh? There's numerous, countless hadith and also ayats that, you know, mention some things that will take place. However, it's more, you find more descriptive detail in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It mentions about the su'alin, the questioning by Munkar wa Nakir, right? And for those, you know, viewing, it is this book that we're going over, Usul al-Din i'tiqadi Muslim, right? Which the first portion of the book is the book by Sheikh Uthman Anfodio, Usul al-Din, his translation of Usul al-Din. And the rest of the text is basically a commentary built off of that called Qawaid al-Iman. And in case you want to purchase it, it can be purchased, you know, by one, you can just physically come down to Master Uthman Anfodio, or you can go on our website, masterdanfodio.com, masterdanfodio.com. Yeah. So anyway, to proceed on. So we'll talk with Munkar and Nakir. This is where they'll question you in your grave. They will ask you, who's your Lord? What was the book revealed, and who was this man that was sent to you, all right? And those who are sinful and those who disbelieve, they will not be able to answer the questions immediately. However, those who believe, they may have been sinful Muslims, Allah will pardon and lighten their load, and they'll be able to answer easily, you know, answer those questions. Once Allah Ta'ala permits them to be the ability to answer, they may suffer some sort of torture. Now, the thing to remember, what is most important here, is that the angels, they don't disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't disobey Allah. And they absolutely obey Allah no matter what the circumstance is. So when they're punishing you in his grave, you know, as the hadiths had described it, they're hitting you in your head. And there's other things that they'll do to you as well as methods of torture. There's other things that goes on in the grave. Like some people, they said, is a hadith mentioned that there'll be angels that the angels will put a hook in your mouth and they'll rip your head back. You know, there's some that will, for women, will be hanging from some sort of tree branch from their breast. I can imagine that's very painful. You know, And some will be hair, cut off from their hair for those who used to expose their body, and so on and so forth. There's all kinds of narrations about just what will take place in the Barzakh, right? Just in that realm alone. And this is going on right now, real time, and it's happening to people right now, real time, right? So anyway, so Munkar Nakir, they will, you know, hit your head with a mallet every time you get the questions wrong, and this will be their method of torture, right? And like I said, there's other means of methods of torture that they will use as well, depending on the sin that the person used to commit in the dunya. So the question of Munkar Nakir in the grave, and other than them, those who are not buried or cremated, you know, those who are buried or cremated, it will still happen to you regardless. The punishment of the grave is real, right? The delight or the na'imuhu, right, is real as well, right? The punishment in the grave, we just spent a little time talking about it. The delight in the grave, where you'll be seeing your place in Jannah, right? And it'll be like one of those things where it's exciting, you know. This feeling, the one feeling I used to always get when I was a kid, wasn't Muslim. And we knew that Christmas was coming, you know. And sometimes, you know, our parents don't hide the gifts good enough, you know. So sometimes you'll run into them and find them in the closet or something like that, you know. And, you know, you'd be like, you know, me, myself, as a little boy, I used to ask my mother, yo, you know, what did I get for Christmas? Did Santa Claus bring me this or bring me that? And she'd be like, well, you got to go to sleep and wait to know. But I was so overwhelmed with excitement and curiosity that I couldn't sleep, you know. And the only thing I had to do was close my eyes, go to sleep for the time that I usually go to sleep, and wake up, right? Well, the same thing, you'll be seeing your place in Jannah. You know, you'll see your wife or your husband in Jannah. You'll see the delights of it. You'll see all of that. You're like, subhanAllah, right? Or it's like a person, you know, who's going off to an island where you can look through the water and see the sand. You know, these things are enticing, and you know, and it brings a peace of mind and joy, right? Well, the same thing, you'll be laying in your, you know, in your grave, you know, may Allah Ta'ala grant all this to us, I mean, you know, and you'll see your place in Jannah. You know, you'll see your reward, and you'll be excited, and you can't wait, you know, and so on and so forth. So now, so then the sheikh, he went on, he mentioned about, he says, "Wa yawm al-qiyamah lahaq," that yawm al-qiyamah is real, right? Now, if you notice his language in the semi-ayat, is bilhaq, 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 bilhaq. Why? This really isn't, there's no room for doubt. Like I said, once again, if you doubt it, this is kufr, right? There's no room for doubt. You know, you can't be like, oh, maybe this will happen or maybe it won't happen, you know. There's no room for doubt. It's something that's absolutely going to happen. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it, right? Okay, so Qiyamah is haq. He said the Ba'ath al-Amwati, the raising of the dead, on the Qiyamah is haq. So, you know, the thing, and this was one of the things that the Quraysh, they used to deny the Qiyamah, right? And it used to be like making mockery, you know, asking questions like as if they're making, so wait a minute, so you telling me that you really believe that these dead people in here, they're going to come back together? Yeah, all right. This is why, bilhaq, this is with truth. This is what we believe within, the, you know, this is our belief, right? And if you go back to the onset of 9/11, if you were Muslim then, right? Alaykum as-salam rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If you were Muslim then around the time of 9/11, I don't think a lot of people even paid attention to it, but there were Muslims that were making claim that the Hurwa'in in Jannah was not real. That Jannah, it was allegory, it wasn't real, you know, it wasn't gonna take place, but rather some metaphor. This was also some of the belief of the followers of Imam W.D. Muhammad, right? This was not the followers, but this was some of his aqidah, right? You know, and they would say things, you know, like such as like, you know, hereafter, what are we hereafter, right? You know, the the mu'ajizat, the miracles of the prophets and things of that nature, it was said, no, these aren't real. But what it meant was this, you know, like one of the miracles of Isa ibn Maryam was that he was able to bring dead back to life, right? Of course, and no miracle, anything that is broken, that is creation is a phenomena for creation, meaning that it breaks the norm. It can only happen by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even things that you take for granted, such as the internet, right? I'm speaking to you from my location where I'm at, and everybody who views this is in different locations of the world, the United States, within the city, within the state of Pennsylvania, outside the state of Pennsylvania, in the city, in the other parts of counties, and so on and so forth. We're not in the same thing, but this can only happen by Allah ta'ala's permission, right? These things, you know, can only happen by that. Think about it. If you take and walk and step on top of water, 9 times out of 10, you'll sink, whether you weigh 80 pounds or 8,000 pounds. However, a hippopotamus can step on that same water and float across it, right? You step on the same water, you'll sink down to the bottom, but however, you send a cruise ship through there that weighs tons, it'll float across, right? This is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right. And so the same things with the prophet's miracles, or even some of the miracles of the performance of the people, the awliya, right? Or even the istiraj of evil people, even, you know, their behaviors. It's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why if one doesn't understand this with the approach and the coming of the Dajjal, and that's a whole nother topic in itself, but with the Dajjal, right? One of the things that the Dajjal Allah gives the Dajjal the ability to do is to kill a man and bring him back to life, right? And people will begin to worship the Dajjal, right? And saying he's Allah, right? However, the person that he killed, according to the narratives of many of the ulama, they said that it would be Khidr, right? And if you don't know who Khidr is, that's your homework. Look him up. Khidr. In English, it's spelled with a K. K-H-I-D-R. Khidr. Right? They say it'll be Khidr. And Khidr will deny them and say that this man was only able to kill. Allah Ta'ala gives life. And he, you know, he also takes life. Right? It's also the behavior of Nimrod. Right? Or Nimrud in Arabic. Right? You know, he said, you know, he gives life, you know, he set a man free from prison and he causes death, you know. But however, he couldn't give life in his reality, right? You know, the same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives life. And then, you know, he says, well, look, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam said to him, said, listen, you know, and also this is Dalila Aqliyah, right? This is the little Aqaliyah. Those people would be like, yo, you know, it has to be, you know, from the text, the source text, and we can't waver. This is where, you know, those who make that claim of holding on and saying that it's impermissible, then they miss the Quran somehow. They miss ayahs of the Quran. So anyway, Ibrahim defeated him, alayhi salam, Nimrud, in that debate by saying, what? My Lord causes the sun to rise from the east. You make it come from the West, right? And of course, he didn't have the ability to do so. So you'll find, you know, you find these arguments in discussions, you know, and it's pertaining to our afterlife. These are things that you have to have firm belief in. So anyway, now, so the raising of the dead on the Qiyamah, on that day, is haq. All right, it's real. He said the Jamu'un Nasi, right? The collection or the gathering of mankind in one place is also real, right? Now, from the time that you mention the Barzakh, usually fear comes over the heart of the believer. From the time you mention your death at its appointed time, over the heart of the believer, you start to feel that fear kicks in. You start remembering, you know, the sins you may have committed. you know, even the sins you've made tawbah from, you're feeling optimistic, but you're also pessimistic at the same time, because you're like, you know, I don't have a firm confirmation that Allah forgave me for that. But however, in my defense of optimism, I did make tawbah for that, right? Things that you may have said, things you may have said and forgotten that you said, things that you may have said that slipped the tongue, salats you may have missed, all of these things start to play once you hit the grave. Because when a person is on his way to death, and I've seen quite a few people at their moments of death, the only joyous individual that I've ever seen was a believer. A person who's a disbeliever, you don't see that much joy. A person who wasn't like the best of Muslim, you don't see that joy. But a believer is always joy. He's very optimistic in his death, you know. He's not, you know, looking for your sympathy, but more so he's find himself submitting, if that's the best words to use, submitting, right? Found himself submissive. And I can almost probably guarantee you that person was submissive his entire life, because the believer, they understand that death comes at its appointed time. That's part of our usuluddin. That's part of our aqidah, right? That death comes at its appointed time. So when it's coming, you're ready. You're embracing your whole life. You embrace for this moment of death, right? We don't party like we're going to be here forever, but rather yet, what we do, we prepare, make preparation for our death by our behavior, by our transmission of the deen, by our teaching our family. We prepare our families for our death and their death by teaching them, you know, what is to be properly believed and so on and so forth and et cetera, et cetera. So from the time where it mentions that death at its appointed time, the events of the barzakh, right? And the more it goes into it, you'll find that the arrangement of how things is, it brings you closer to optimism. Your scariest moments, we get to with the hashr, or the more so what they call it, the jam', right? Where you bring everybody together, the hashr is like the, you know, to usher everyone together, and jam'ah is more so collecting, you know, the collective body of people together, right? You get to that point. That point is terrifying. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was telling his sahabas about this time to come, about the gathering. And he described it so much so, the sahabas, they develop a vivid image in their mind. So much so, Aisha, our mother, radiallahu ta'ala anha, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said, will we be naked, Ya Rasulullah? Because there'll be men and women next to each other, right? On this day, collectively, right? And you're accountable, you're going to be account, the account is being ran, right? Of everything you did, and that's, we're going to get to that point. Get to that point. They said that it's terrifying. Some of the events that will take place during this terrifying moment will be that there'll be a lot of crying. And there's a lot of crying because of the fact you remember the things that you used to do. But not only you do you personally remember them, they will be read back to you. Because remember, we talked about in the beginning, we confirmed the existence of the Malaika of angels, right? Didn't go into detail. The only names that was mentioned from amongst the Malaika was Munkar wa Nakir, right? There's Raqib and Atib, that's also angels. And these are the angels that come with you from the time you become an adult, right? An adult. And in Islam, adulthood starts at what is labeled as puberty, right? When you become pubescent, okay? It starts at puberty. So that's an early time. For some people, puberty starts at like 11, right? So from the time you become pubescent, the angels are writing in that scroll, okay? And it's going to get to this point. But however, you're going to be reminded of things that you've done in this dunya, things that you said, behaviors that you displayed, beliefs that you held in this life. You'll be reading them back to yourself. So what's supposed to take place is that people will begin to cry because they think of, they thought of and remembered the things they used to do. Now, see, thinking about the Qiyamah is very humbling. It's a very humbling experience. And the reason being is because you don't have no more control over your life. You don't have no control. You are subjugated to whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for you. You're subjugated to that. There ain't no getting around that. Right? So you'll begin to cry. And they say some people will cry so much, as the Prophet says, you know what I'm saying? Some people will cry so much that they will begin to dry, run out of tears, and they will begin to cry blood. Because this time is such a terrifying time. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she asked, will we be uncovered? And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam assured her that yes, we will, and we'll be so busy worried about what we've done in the events that are taking place that they're not even going to be thinking about someone next to them that's not covered. No. So to move on, so the Jama'a Nasi, the collection of the people in one place on the Qiyamah, is haq, is truth. The itau kutub, the giving of the scrolls, is true. It's haq, right? And those scrolls contain everything that was written down by those two angels, Raqib and Atib, right? Everything that's in there, right? Everything that's in there. Now, there is ways that these scrolls will be given. Everybody receives them. If you receive your scroll in your right hand, this is an indication that you'll be amongst the people of Ahl al-Jannah. If you receive your kutub, your scroll, on your left hand, in your left hand, this is an indication that you'll be amongst the people of the fire. Then you'll have people that will even try not to even take the scrolls. These are, all these things are confirmed by means of the Quran and by means of the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Some of them will try to hide their hand and put it behind their back. And they said that the scroll will be thrusted through their body and still placed in their hand. May Allah Ta'ala protect us and make us all be people who receive the scrolls on their right hand. I mean. He mentions now the wazn al-a'mal, the scale that weighs your actions. This is why it's so important, especially with the approaching of Ramadan. Actions will be rewarded. Those actions that normally were nafl actions or sunnah actions will be rewarded as fard. They'll get the weight of being an action that is obligatory. The reward. This is why Ramadan is such a blessed time. Sometimes I think that we get the wrong, it's not the wrong idea, it's actually the right idea. But the mind state is because we're so beat down because we spend most of our time sinning, right? That we think, you know, because Ramadan is that month of rahmah, that month of mercy, and this is why it's called that, because it's nothing but thawab, it's nothing but reward. Can you go into Ramadan and get the very minimal amount of reward? Absolutely. All you have to do is sit idle. Just do what's required of you. Even in Allah's mercy, you still get a lot of reward for that. Could you go in and cash out in Ramadan Absolutely. By doing all the nafil actions, praying the Tarawih. This is why Ramadan, and Ramadan is like, you know, like a video game, like Mario. I believe most of us played Mario at one point in time in life. Or Sonic the Hedgehog, right? You get to a certain part in the board, it's like a bonus board, and you collect a bunch of rings, and you get all your coins and your pennies and things like that, and you rack it up, and all you hear is ding, 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 right? Think of Sonic. And he hits a spike, all of his bling, all of his rings and everything go everywhere. Think about our good deeds. Ramadan is that bonus board for us. Rack up. Can you ruin it? Yeah, you can ruin it. But this is why Ramadan is the month of Rahmah, right? It's a Shahr al-Rahmah. It's a month of Rahmah, you know. So the wazn al-a'mal is real. The weighing of your actions, you know, your behaviors is real. And you want to spend time accumulating and doing good so you can get that reward for good. Well, hisab, the reckoning, right? The hisab, the reckoning, where now you'll be questioned about everything you've done. You know those scrolls? Now you'll be questioned about those, held accountable for those actions. Now it gets optimistic because the optimism begins to kick in. I'm telling you, it was dreadful from the time we heard about Mout, death, up to this point. You know, it's still dark and gloomy for us because you start thinking, you know, like, subhanAllah, you know, start making you reflect, you know. Like, man, you know, all these things are happening. I'm being held accountable, man. I ain't been the best person, you know. And even think about it. When you ever read the hadith about shifa, right, about intercession, all of the prophets are considered ma'zum, right? They're considered sinless, okay? There was an event for each prophet that they took as if it was the worst thing that they've ever could have done. And so they say, don't come to me. Go to such and such and ask him to help you. Because me, I did so on and so forth, right? And they considered that action to be that heinous to say, hey, look, I ain't the person you want to intercede for you. Go to such and such, all right? And they do this all the way until they get to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ says, and this is also part of our aqidah, is that the shifa, right? The shifa, the intercession, it is for the people who committed a lot of sins from amongst his ummah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? And there's also different types of shifa where your children will intercede. If you have a child that memorized the Quran, the child will intercede for you. If you were memorizing Quran and you died, wherever you last memorized that, that will be your intercessor. So there's going to be some shifa. There's going to be some interceding for the people who may have committed some errors, but also done good as well. Done a lot of good, right? No. So from the hisab, then it brings you to the sirat, okay? The sirat, they say this is a bridge. It's thin, very thin, like a string of hair. And people will cross it at different speeds. A person who was a person that was of righteousness, they'll get through it very fast, right? A person who was righteous, but he also had bad deeds mixed with him, he'll move across it slow, he'll slide across, you know. But then those who disbelieved, committed sins, where their sins outweighed the good, and so on and so forth. Some of them will get dragged across the sirat on their face. Some of them will be crossing the sirat and dropping to the hellfire, and because this bridge is also over the hellfires, right? They'll drop off of the sirat into the fire. And those who cross it, okay, of course, it's a sign of optimism that you're going to reach paradise, okay? The Kawthar, also known as the Hawd. This takes place in Jannah. And this is definitely a bonus reward of paradise for the believer, the one who followed the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This hadith is mentioned also in the Muwatta Imam Malik, and also in Bukhari, and I believe also Muslim. It mentions about the person who makes wudu. He makes wudu properly, right? And the limbs will shine. Those limbs made sure he properly washed. They will shine like light. This is how you'll be recognized. The people of the Hawd, you'll be recognized by this. But as far as Ahlul Bid'ah, the people of innovation, they won't share this Hawd. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi will meet you at the Hawd. This is where you'll link up with the Prophet Sallallahu in Jannah, in the afterlife in Jannah. He'll meet you at the Hawd. And we'll recognize each other by the light from our limbs. But if you are a person of innovation, it mentions that they will be dragged away from the Hawd. Now, think of a parent who sees their child and they're waiting for them, right? And they're trying to reach them. They're walking towards them. But then the authorities come and they grab them. And pull them away. They grab them and pull them away. Get over here. And they thought they were going to Jannah, or to the Hawd, I should say. Likewise, a person thought they were going to link up with their parents. Now, remind you, keep in mind, bear this in mind, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is waiting to greet us at the Hawd. He can't wait to be with us at the Hawd. It's like the parent, listen, I ain't seen my son in 10 years. Come on, son, right? And you're excited. And then all of a sudden, the authorities come and grab you and take you away. Now the parent is like, yo, what are you doing? This is my son. What's wrong? Right? The same way the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will say, my ummati. This is my ummah. They're with me. What's going on? The angels will snatch the person up. The angels' reply will be, you don't know what they've invented after you. And so then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will say, Shakart. I don't want nothing to do with him. Take him away. Get him out of here. Right? That's how that event will feel. The Prophet ﷺ is waiting to greet you. You've never physically met the Prophet ﷺ in your life, but you will meet him at the Hawd. And you'll blow that opportunity because you invented things in the deen after the Prophet ﷺ. So this is haq, this is real. Also, to get another idea of the Kauthar, look up Surah Kauthar. I believe that's what, Surah 108. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong. I believe it's Surah 108 in the Quran. Look up the tafsir. Inna a'tainaka al-kauthar. It's kind of one of them stories, you know, of the sabab, the cause of why it was revealed, the backstory to it. It'll kind of like, you know, make you probably bring out some tears, right? SubhanAllah. But anyway, so the Hawd, the Kauthar. Next, he talks about the Nar, the fire. It's haq, it's real. Wadawamu anar, and it's eternal, right? It doesn't burn out, as one scholar held the belief that it burns out, that hellfire wasn't eternal, it dies out, like the flame just, it's gone, right? And with his people in it, Ahliha, it's also real. It's 8 levels of hellfire, right? Some narrations give the indication that there's 7. The lowest is for the munafiq, for the one who pretended to be Muslim, but he never believed. The second lowest, or the level over that, is for the disbelievers. Yahuwah, Nasara, Hindu, whatever it was that they worship, right? The lightest punishment that is mentioned from a hadith, and it's a punishment just restricted for the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Talib, is those sandals made of fire that boil his brain, and he believed that that is the hottest part of hellfire, right? But let's pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects us from any of the fire. Don't let any of the fire touches us. Let us be forgiven before we reach that fire. Ameen. The next one now, so, you know, it goes from pessimistic, 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 pessimistic. I think we didn't hit rock bottom when we started talking about nar, right? I didn't even begin to talk about the description of the fire, how it burns, right? And I'm, you know, to save time for the sake of time, I won't go too detailed in it. But just to talk about the reality of the fire will burn your skin, right? If a person's ever been burnt and had a third degree burn, that's a real bad burn, right? It'll burn the skin off, but it'll grow back, right? If you get burnt in this dunya, the outcome, the worst outcome, worst case scenario is you're going to die from those burnings. Well, there's no death in the afterlife, right? There's no death for you. So you'll be getting burned, the skin will grow back, and it'll just keep burning, and it'll grow back, and it'll burn, and it'll grow back, and it'll just keep burning, and it'll keep burning, and, you know, and this will be your state. And if you're Muslim, this will go on until Allah Ta'ala takes you, you know, allows you, permits you to come out of the fire. Now, so anyway, to speed up, paradise. It's 8 levels of paradise, or 7. They're all true. Paradise is eternal. Dawamu. Dawamu wa ahliha. It's eternal in its people. It's also true. Right? Then the final thing is the ru'ya. Right? The believers will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next life. It's haq. Be like kayfiyya wa la ma'ana. You know, without how, without direction, and so on and so forth. We do tafweed. Is this khalas? That's what it says. That's how we accept it, right? It's real. It's mentioned in the Quran. And his sheikh, he concludes the last part of the semi'at. He says, all that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with is truth, right? It's the truth. Everything that he came with is the truth from the Quran, the narration, the hadith that he narrates, you know, hadith al-Qudsi, so on and so forth. It's all haq. It's all truth. Right? He says, these are the foundations of the deen. Usulu diniya, it's ilahiyat, it's nabawiyyatuha, right? It's prophetic, and it's afterlife, the sami'iyyatuhu, right? All of which have confirmed in the Quran. And it is obligatory upon every legally mature and responsible person, mukhalif, right? And mukhalif is a person that has reached all of the signs of adulthood, or also known as a puberty, right? Where they have a discharge, sexual discharge of semen, you know, any discharge, any sexual discharge. Menstruation for women, you know, facial hair, and so on and so forth. You know, those are the signs of being mukhalif, right? Which means that everyone is accountable at this point. So he says, this is mandatory upon every legally responsible and mature person to accept them exactly as they came to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and messengers, right? And in the case of the awam, in the case of the common people, simple belief in them and acceptance of all these tenets is sufficient, right? And this really should, you have to be able to a person that has barakah with them, they have to be able to bring together the people together and not have the people separated or casting people into a category that they don't belong into. So the sheikh, this is what the sheikh is saying here. In the case of the amma, the common, everyday common people, simple belief in them and acceptance of all these tenets is sufficient. In the case of the khasasa, right? In the case of those people who are elite, meaning that they have the ability to go on and delve into the kifaya, the collective obligation, meaning going into ilm al-kalam, he says, they form the basis of the further knowledge. So this is like the doorway for you to continue your studies in aqidah. But if you don't go any further in your studies of aqidah, your iman is sound. So if you didn't go no further than this, your iman is sound. Go learn tajweed, read the Quran, go learn your basis of fiqh, you know, learn the Arabic language, and you don't go no further than that, alhamdulillah, you are a sound Muslim, right? In today's time, I think what has happened is that we're learning that is being promoted, and a lot of this is book learned stuff, and some of this is students being overzealous, where they make the everyday person delve into the higher studies of the science of aqidah. And this is what he's getting at. Because when that happens, then you have a conundrum, because there's a lot of mixture, a mix and match going on. You know, people are speaking out of term and they're going into these things and they're spreading these ideas. And then you also have to have a group of men, which I call them like special forces, right? You send them in. You don't send a large army in. You send in the special force. You send in the Delta forces, right? You know, or, you know, those individuals, you know, that go in, and the SEALs, you know, it takes 6 men when they can take out 600 people. These are the men that you go in to go debate, you know, people with deviant ideology, such as the Mu'tazila, the Shia, and so on and so forth, right? Those are the people that you send in there, right? So he says, this is because of the difficulty they, meaning the common people, have in understanding the adilla, right? And there's been times where I'll have a discussion with a person and they look perplexed when you're getting all deep and detailed, and they just like, look, I don't know about all that shit. You know, all I know is this is what Allah says, khalas, right? And there's no problem with that. That doesn't take away from them being a good Muslim, because they could be better Muslim than the one who knows how to explain all of these things, right? But anyway, he says, this is also the opinion held by Sheikh Izzuddin, right? Ibn Abdul Salam. He's Abdulaziz, that's his first name, but his nickname is Izzuddin, right? They call him the Sultan al-Ulama, right? That he's the scholar of the learned men. And he says in his Qawa'id al-Ahkam fi Islah al-Nam, right? Which is the books pertaining to the principles of the legal rulings in the interests of mankind. He said, therefore, the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not require anyone who became Muslim to investigate into the details and the specifics of these things that were mentioned, but however, he will make them firm, since it was known that they would be separate from him. The Khalifa, the Khulafa al-Rashideen, the rightly guided Khalifs, the Ulama Amilin, Ulama Mutahideen, the rightly guided scholars, did not cease confirming them in that. And so wherever you read, if you're reading one of the texts of the Shehu, and he says, I say, this is meaning from his ijtihad, he says, as for those who are amongst the Ahlul Basira, people of insight, it is obligatory upon him for him to act upon his insight regarding these elements in order to emerge from blind following, right? He also must have clear understanding, basira, of his i'tiqadihi, his belief system. And the deen is built upon clear insight, tabasuri, right? For the people of basir, for people of insight, especially if someone has reached the maqam of giving da'wah. And you reached the maqam, the station. He says, this is my way, and I invite to Allah Ta'ala with understanding, and those who follow me. And this is from the Quran, Surah to Yusuf. The ayah is 108. Now, and he says, here ends the book of the Usuluddin. And he says, O Allah, give us success in following the sunnah of your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, completed with the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the best help, the best of his help. Alhamdulillah wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Ameen. So we'll stop there. So the next class, inshallah, we will be getting a little more into the commentary with, you know, the evidences and proofs and things, you know, pertaining to that, inshallah. Like I said, if you haven't got a copy of the text, you know, you can purchase it from our website, or you can, you know, contact me and, you know, I can direct you to how to purchase the text, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all and continue to increase in khair as we get closer and closer into Ramadan. Inshallah, let's have high himma going into the month of Ramadan, the month of mercy. And like I said, we'll continue these classes throughout the month, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Next week's class, which should be Saturday around 8:30, inshallah. All right. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.